having a bite. It sucks.
That's not the point of the
game. I know!
When people try to explain what the metaverse is, even people who really believe in it, they point to dystopian science fiction. You might think, why the hell would anyone think that it's a good idea to recreate dystopian science fiction? But in their defense, these fictional metaverses are never just dystopian. They're dystopias that contain utopias, whether that's a world made completely of pop culture references from your childhood, or a world where you can modify your own body without the need for doctors or politicians' approval. Metaverses that already exist provide a place for people to act out their fantasies. The promise of the metaverse is often the promise of a world where everything can be bright and shiny, or at least brighter and shinier than the real world, where you can surpass the physical bounds of your abilities, your appearance, your location, and so on. Like, no more bodies. Society surpassed the need for bodies. But who are you, truly? Your body or your mind? René Descartes was a guy who sat in his pajamas and thought a lot. You probably learned about his graphing system in math class, and you might know him from his famous catchphrase, "I think, therefore I am," or "Cogito, ergo sum," if you're an asshole. He came to this conclusion during a thought experiment he did while sitting in his pajamas and thinking a lot. He was like, how can we know anything is real? My body could be fake because an evil demon could be making me dream that I have a body when I actually don't. Just like in The Matrix. But even if my body is fake, there has to be some real part of me thinking that my body could be fake. I exist because I can think about the fact that I exist. My body might not exist, but my mind definitely does. And thus spouted one of the big theories supporting mind-body dualism. The idea that your mind is somehow different from your body, that there's a sense of I or me other than this. There's so much f***ing dog hair in here.
Always.
Nasty. Nasty. I mean, I eat his hair all the time. It's actually not that nasty. The metaverse seems to agree with Descartes on this point. The perfect metaverse proposes that you can replace your physical body with a virtual one, because your physical body isn't really you. Your mind is. Some fringe scientists take this to the extreme. In January 2016, Sergio Canavero and Ren Xiaoping announced that they cut off two monkeys' heads, and using surgery skills and polyethylene glycol, they put one monkey's head on the other monkey's body. And then they took a picture, and then Canavero shared it to the media, and then thousands of people went, what the fuck? Why? Why does this exist? This is so fucked up. This image and procedure was lauded by Canavero as evidence that he and Ren had successfully completed a monkey head transplant, and that they would successfully complete a human head transplant by 2017. Apparently, the human head transplant would involve a specialized crane that would move the head from one body to the other, which is fascinating and horrifying. Some people justify Canavero and Ren's research on the grounds that it might help people with spinal cord injuries, which is fair, although there are people studying spinal cord injuries who aren't cutting monkeys' heads off, so... Also, it seems like Canavero himself doesn't even claim to be doing this research to help people with spinal cord injuries. Like, in his 2015 TED Talk, he basically says that spinal cords that are injured by the real world just can't be repaired.
This is spinal cord injury. It's unrecoverable.
Only those that are cut by his ultra-specialized diamond knives can be repaired. In his TED Talk, he isn't like, I'm doing such good work for people with spinal cord injuries. Instead, he's like, when we can clone ourselves, we can use my techniques to graft our old brains into our new bodies, and therefore we can achieve immortality, or at least another 40 years of life. Just so you know, according to TED himself, this talk appears to fall outside TEDx's curatorial guidelines, and contains statements about nerve regeneration that are questioned by many neuroscientists. Just thought you should know that. This concept and the way that Canavero seems to think is to me indicative of supreme retreating into the mind. Like, to him, humans are minds, so you can graft brains onto bodies that did not grow those brains, and the person whose brain it was will continue to be themselves in their new bodies. Other things that Canavero's done seem to support this idea that he subconsciously sees himself and other people as like floating minds chained to our bodies. Like, he wrote a pickup artist book, Dones Caperte, that claims to tell you how to open the doors of female infidelity, how to exploit women's needs and weaknesses for your benefit. Specifically, by taking advantage of some brain-thinking techniques, you can learn to manage the brain, or mind if you want, and the body of the woman for sexual purposes. And then he also says that we humans just have to have sex because we are incapable of killing our primordial impulses. This book completely ignores that having sex is a collaborative physical act, and instead treats it both as an inconvenience and as mind games. Fun. Although I will admit that this is just speculation based on the summary on Amazon, so if anyone who knows Italian would like to read it and report back, feel free! Some cryonics projects, also known as freezing human bodies and heads in the hope of resurrecting them later, even aspire to place your brain or mind in a robot or upload it to the cloud, taking this literal mind-body separation even further. Not only can you change bodies and remain yourself, you can remain yourself with no human body at all! But hopefully you are not in need of a human head transplant and you probably don't have the funds to seriously invest in cryonics. So what might this mind-body split actually mean for you? Well, one way it could be significant is that if you can convince someone that all other humans have a mind separate from their physical bodies, then maybe you can also convince them that all those other humans are also equal to them, regardless of their bodies. Descartes, for example, collaborated a lot philosophically with a woman, Princess Elizabeth, and trained artisans and peasants into admired mathematicians, seemingly looking beyond bodies and seeing minds. So a mind-body separation can be a kind of an equalizer.
Wait for my breath, I have to stop
pissing. In 1985, Donna Haraway wrote a big, very difficult to read article called A Cyborg Manifesto that basically said, you know how tech is taking over our lives? You know, the tech that's invented by the military and often used to kill and oppress people? Well, if you really think about it, this tech is actually liberatory because now we can reconstruct ourselves to be anything we want. And so we can overcome our differences of gender and race. We're no longer women and men and black and white. Now we're all the same. We're all cyborgs. We could see this same logic applied to the metaverse. One of the implicit promises of it is that it can be an equalizer. In the metaverse of Ready Player One, for example, a high school teen just like you can rule the world, and a kind of chubby Canadian girl with a birthmark could be his beautiful love interest. If you usually used a wheelchair, there, you can walk all the time. If you've always hated and been teased for your big nose, there, you can make it small. And if you hate your patchy skin, or your hair texture, or your skin tone, just change it all. If you're fat, make your avatar thin. If you speak English with an accent, just use a voice filter to make you sound normal. Hopefully you're seeing what the problem is. The version of inclusion that involves empowering people to change their bodies requires people who are different from the accepted normal to ignore and literally erase their differences. So it isn't really inclusion. Likewise, Haraway's ideas have not been taken very well by people whose bodies are different from hers. Julia R. De Cook, for example, in her paper critiquing A Cyborg Manifesto's Whiteness, suggests that the best way to read Haraway might be to understand cyborg as just another identity that people can take on alongside other identities, not a unifying one. And cyborg Gillian Weiss points out that there are actual real cyborgs, disabled people who have to rely on technology for day-to-day tasks, who have priorities that are very different from Donna Haraway and other triborgs. I know how to light a candle. Oh my god, fire hazard. It's all good, it's all good, it's all good. Haraway's theory here is kind of like when people say that they're not racist because they just don't see race. Like, yes, humans are humans and they deserve fundamental respect regardless of their race, gender, ability, and so on. But when someone has a different body from you, that can also mean that they have fundamentally different experiences from you. Racism, sexism, transphobia, ableism, and so on cause lived inequalities beyond hatred. Our bodies shape our experiences, which shape our minds. And put simply, focusing on minds only means ignoring context. And ignoring context means that you cannot solve contextual problems. Descartes' context, for example, was that he lived in Holland, the center of Dutch trade, while the Dutch West India Company became the center of the transatlantic slave trade in Europe. But Descartes did not speak about the people who were being bought and sold in Amsterdam. Some thinkers forgive him for this, saying that, whoa, pointing to his work as an equalizer, and saying that enslavement justified by race was just not in the public or philosophical discourse enough for Descartes to need to talk about it. Other thinkers, however, suggest that Descartes' construction of a pure, rational, white, universal subject laid the groundwork for others, like Louis XIV, to justify treating non-white people as inhuman. A lot of the publicity about Wren and Canevaro's work on the human head transplant, like Canevaro's TED Talk on it, date to 2015-2016. And a lot of the publicity centers around the human who volunteered for it, Valery Spirinidov, who has a muscle-wasting disease and accordingly only had 5 years to live. So he saw this surgery, which Canevaro promised could happen by 2017, as a way to continue living. And hey, if it's your only option to stay alive, it's understandable why you might be interested in this possibility and interested in promoting it. But 3 years later, in 2019, Spirinidov withdrew as a volunteer, partially because Canevaro's optimistic timeline of surgery by 2017 was just wrong. Plus, Spirinidov's condition remained stable over the years, so this surgery wasn't as urgent as he maybe once thought. And perhaps most importantly, as Spirinidov said in a video on his YouTube channel, even if the surgery was feasible, he just wouldn't do it now because of his responsibilities to his family and his job. Explaining that, he said something that I found very poetic, that despite being famous for volunteering for a head transplant, he just can't wait for this surgery forever. His life is a lot bigger than this. To me, this suggests that people like him don't necessarily need expensive, invasive, risky, morally murky medical intervention, but to be accepted as they are. To be given the opportunities to live fulfilling lives within the bodies that they have now. Like, one disabled activist in my city fought to get an accessible mat installed at the beach. And the day it was installed, she went down to the beach and out on the mat and saw the sunset, and was the closest to the water she'd been in a decade. Later, she saw a man in a motorized wheelchair and pointed out the mat to him, and his eyes lit up, and he used it too, wheeled out towards the shore. She was gonna ask his opinions on how it was to use it as a motorized wheelchair user, but seeing him look out on the water, she just didn't want to disturb what seemed like a profound moment, and thought that seeing him enjoy it was all she needed to know. And finally, when she left the beach about an hour later, she noticed that he was still there, taking it in. One of my favorite refutations of Descartes' idea that we can't prove that there's an external reality beyond our own minds comes from George Edward Moore. Whoop. Which goes, "Here is one hand, and here is another. There are at least two external objects in the world. Therefore, an external world exists."
Ah, you think the physical world might not be real? Then catch these hands, motherfucker!
I love this not just because I think it's fucking hilarious, but also because I think it celebrates and affirms our basic humanity and animal existence. Many philosophers and techies want us to ignore or forget that we have bodies and become floating minds of pure reason or renderings of zeros and ones in a dataset. Beyond addressing racial, disability, and gender inequalities, having a body is also just really nice. We're animals. We are bodies. And our bodies want warmth and touch and food and water. And call me a hedonist, but I think indulging our flesh and enjoying being embodied is one of the main points of being alive. Even Dr. Canevaro seems to agree with me on this point. Admittedly, although Zuck's pitch for the metaverse is depressing, limited, and uninspiring, maybe some genuinely innovative things will come out of the billions of dollars that they're pouring into it. You can never predict how end users will use the things you're making. Like, growing up, I spent most of my time at home, so I connected with the wider world in forums, World of Warcraft, Neopets, Club Penguin, Tumblr, and YouTube, and I'm sure the inventors of the DARPANET didn't have my adolescent development in mind. These internet connections were invaluable to my understanding of the world and having casual social connections alongside my real life. As I said, metaverses provide a place for people to enact their fantasies, and I do think that's valuable and overall a good thing. But there is and always will be more to our lives than our online experiences. And plus, doing stuff online a lot or too much can also sometimes actually create a distance from our physical bodies and contexts by encouraging a kind of retreat from our bodies, ignoring them in favor of our minds and our screens. And then finally, Zuck specifically is not trying to do this for virtuous reasons. He is running a company, and that company is trying to make as much money as possible. So the metaverse to them is a promise of a world filled with ads and microtransactions, where they always get a cut. So resist your local tech overlord today by logging off. But before you do, hit like, comment, subscribe, hit the notification bell, and so on. And if you would like to stay in the virtual world for a little longer, feel free to watch more of my videos. Maybe stretch first. Thank you. I inhaled so much bath water.
I feel like a drowned rat.
Let's make me feel better.